Hey everyone, welcome to worship. My name is Tim Sievers. I'm the Connection Director here at Palouse Federated Church. I'm so glad you could join us. I want to share with you a few announcements. As you may have guessed, things are constantly changing in this world that we live in, and with the spread of COVID in our communities, we're making a few changes. The annual meeting previously scheduled for today is canceled. We are postponing that until the 27th of February. We encourage you to be safe, look out for your own health, and remember to check in on your neighbors too. In the meantime, you can pick up a copy of the annual report next time you're here at the church, or we can email it to you or mail it to you. You can just let us know if you'd like that at next@palousechurch.org. We're also putting off Sunday school for the same time frame, so we won't be having Sunday school from now until February 27th. Keep your eyes open for more details as that date gets closer. We will update you, and if things turn around dramatically, it could change even before then. But those are our tentative changes. Additionally, we're continuing to look for volunteers to serve on many teams that assist with the work of the church here in Palouse. And if you're interested in using your giftedness for the kingdom, you can let us know, and we can connect you to one of the very many teams that we have doing work in the church and community, teams like Sunday school ministry, kitchen, prayer, congregational care, facilities, greeting, and tech. And I'm sure there's probably even more than that. So if you'd like to connect to one of those places, let us know, and we will help you out. So tune in to this video announcement, and then we'll begin worship on the other side.
Hi, I'm Betty Sawyer, and I'd just like to remind you we have several wonderful Bible studies you can attend in Zoom or in person here at the church. I am privileged to get to teach the Wednesday morning one, and we meet at 9:30. Several ladies join us. There are Bible studies for mixed groups and men's way too early study. There are lots of them this week, so make sure you check our schedule and join us.
Hey folks, Pastor Corey here. I want to encourage you to check out our spiritual growth guide. It's been revised and updated for 2022. It's got a ton of content in here, and we are having meetings on Wednesday nights at 6:30 for adults and teens who are interested in the topics inside here. And each moment in our Sunday services, we're going to talk briefly about the spiritual growth guide. But I wanted you to just know that there's all kinds of things in here about our church, our mission, our values, how we do things. But there's things in here about grieving, about celebrating, about making goals for your life. There's a whole section, a new section on Christian spiritual disciplines. And so this whole guide, the spiritual growth guide, is aimed at helping each of us grow spiritually. What are you going to do in this new year, 2022, to grow spiritually? I hope one of the things you do is ask for a copy of the Spiritual Growth Guide. You can contact me or Tim Sievers or call the church and let us know that you want one copy or a few copies for your family or a group you're a part of, and we will get these to you. There's a suggested donation of $10 per copy, but that's not required. We just want everybody who wants to grow spiritually, that's part of our church family, near or far, to have this resource. So check out the Spiritual Growth Guide for 2022.
Welcome to worship. Our hope is in God all our lives. God is our rock and refuge, a fortress against threat and shame. God has held us since our birth. So never are we in the full grasp of the unjust and cruel. In love, God saves and supports us. Trusting in God, let us offer our praise. Would you pray with me? God of life, death, and resurrection, we are grateful for life. We are grateful for life and all its gifts. Increase in us the stuff that life is made of: faith, hope, and love, but especially love, that we may abide with you eternally. Amen. Amen.
I'm Robin Rylett. Good morning. This is today's call to worship. Psalm 71, verses 1 through 6. In you, O Lord, do I take refuge. Let me never be put to shame. In your righteousness, deliver me and rescue me. Incline your ear to me and save me. Be to me a rock of refuge, to which I may continually come. You have given the command to save me, for you are my rock and my fortress. Rescue me, O my God, from the hand of the wicked, from the grasp of the unjust and cruel man. For you, O Lord, are my hope, my trust, O Lord, from my youth. Upon you I have leaned from before my birth. You are he who took me from my mother's womb. My praise is continually of you.
There's nothing worth more that can ever come close. Nothing can compare. You are a living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted of the sweetest of loves, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Your glory.
Hello, everyone. Pastor Corey Lahiri, and I'm coming to you from my backyard here in Palouse, Washington. Tina and I have been in COVID isolation, quarantine, whatever you want to call it, these last few days. Starting to feel better, and I'm glad to be with you. And I'm glad for technology that can connect us together. We come together at this time to pray together, and our Lord Jesus taught us how to pray, gave us the great teaching, the Lord's Prayer, to lead us to deepen our prayer life with Him. And we've been going through it phrase by phrase the last couple of weeks. And so this week I want to focus on the first two words, Our Father, Our Father. When we pray the Lord's Prayer, think about those words, that together, our, in the plural, we get to call God our Father. And this is something we shouldn't take for granted, that we're in God's family. God uses a family term. I know some people have a problem with the fatherhood language, and I don't want to pick that fight today. That's not important to me right now, because what is important to me is that God wants us to be part of God's family. And so that is something we need to think about when we pray. We're praying to a God who is drawing us in, a God who is welcoming us home, a God who wants us to be close to Him, a God who wants us to call Him Father. And that means we, through Jesus Christ, are God's children. So when you pray, remember that you are praying to a good God, not a distant, mean God, a judgmental God, but a God who is calling you home, calling you to be children of Him. Our Father. Let's pray together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. Lord God, we thank you that you want to be our leader of our family, that you call us to be your children, that you've made the way possible for us to be forgiven and invited into your home, to have your Spirit with us. We thank you for doing this through Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus, we thank you for the gift of prayer, that we can talk to you and listen to you, that we can call out to you on behalf of others. Help us to take this gift seriously, Lord. We lift up to you now those who are sick and hurting, Lord. We pray for your comfort, for your healing. Lord, so many in this world, so many in our communities are in need of your restoring touch. We pray for them. We pray for the healers, the frontline workers, the emergency response workers and volunteers, Lord. Be with them. And we give you thanks for the blessing of having so many who work on our behalf. We pray for our local church, local churches in our area and around the world, that we would be your people, that we would live listening to your Spirit, and that we would share your good news with the world around us. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen.
This is today's second scripture reading. It is 1 Corinthians 13, 1 through 13. If I speak in the tongues of men and of angels, but have not love, I am a noisy gong or a clanging cymbal. And if I have prophetic powers and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have all faith so as to remove mountains, but have not love, I am nothing. If I give away all I have, and if I deliver up my body to be burned, but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. As for prophecies, they will pass away. As for tongues, they will cease. As for knowledge, it will pass away. For we know in part, and we prophesy in part, but when the perfect comes, the partial will pass away. When I was a child, I spoke like a child. I thought like a child. I reasoned like a child. When I became a man, I gave up childish ways. For now we see in a mirror dimly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, then I shall know fully, even as I have been fully known. So now faith, hope, and love abide, these three. But the greatest of these is love.
Our spotlight on giving today is mission giving. Did you know that 10% of every gift you give to our general fund is designated to mission giving? Those funds are divided among our various partners here in Palouse, throughout our region, and around the world. In 2021, we supported Mission Northwest, our partner for education and training and missions, CareNet of Palouse, missionaries Walt and Janine White, Mission Aviation Fellowship missionaries Joe and Karen Adams in Lesotho, Adult and Teen Challenge, Spokane Men's Campus, Kairos outside of Eastern Washington, a prison ministry, Ross Point Camp, our Uganda mission, and many more. It's exciting to see the kingdom grow through the work we do together on mission. So thank you for your faithful giving that really helps people to depend on Jesus. It loves and serves our neighbors here on the Palouse, and it reaches across the world with the good news and the love of Jesus. You can connect to our mission and ministries through your giving. You can give through the mail. You can give when you're at church by dropping a contribution in the offering plate. You can even give online at palousechurch.org. Thank you for your faithful giving.
Thank you.
Loneliness. Loneliness is one of the great human struggles. I've been blessed these last few days to be in isolation with my wife, and so I haven't been lonely. But loneliness is a real issue with human beings in this world. It's kind of strange, isn't it? That we can be lonely with so many people in this world, billions of people. It's not a surprise to God that humans struggle with loneliness. He knew this about us. He knew about our ability, I guess you could say, to divide within our families and in our communities, and to find ourselves lonely, even in a town full of people, a world full of people. And this is one of the sinister consequences of sin, the brokenness of loneliness. So God knows the pain of it. And the good news is God's been wanting to restore and heal our brokenness. God wants to be with us and give us His very Spirit. God doesn't want us alone, never did want us to be alone. God wants us in the family. God wants God's Spirit inside of us. Let's pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts, may they be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, dear Lord. For you are truly our rock and our Redeemer. You alone should we rightly fear. You alone should we fully follow. You alone should our life be founded upon. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and hearts that rejoice at your truth. May your Spirit lead us, Lord. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We find ourselves in the Gospel of John today. That's the fourth book of the New Testament. If you want to turn that way in your Bible, your app, whatever you use, John 14, starting with verse 15, Jesus is preparing his disciples. He knows the cross is coming. He knows the resurrection is coming. He knows that he's preparing the future church. And so he's teaching them important truths that they need to know, that we need to know. John 14, starting with verse 15. If you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another helper to be with you forever, even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him nor knows him. You know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Yet a little while, and the world will see me no more, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. In that day you will know that I am in the Father, and you in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commandments and keeps them, he it is who loves me. And he who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I will love him and manifest myself to him. Judas, not Iscariot, said to him, Lord, how is it that you will manifest yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus answered him, If anyone loves me, he will keep my word, and my Father will love him, and we will come to him and make our home with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words, and the word that you hear is not mine, but the Father's who sent me. These things I have spoken to you while I am still with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things and bring to remembrance all that I have said to you. That's the word of the Lord for us today. And our big point is that we have good news from Jesus, that Jesus is going to go to the cross, right? But he is going to return, and he will come to us, and he's going to leave us with the Helper, the Holy Spirit. That's the real big point today, that Jesus leaves us with the Helper, the Holy Spirit. And so if we are his people, and if we believe in him, as many around the world say that they do, we should have the evidence of his love in his life, living out his commands to love God and love others. And if we truly are his people, we'll be doing that, and we'll be aided by the Holy Spirit to live out his teachings in our life. So let's look at this section today. First, let's talk about loving and obeying God. Some people hear obedience or obeying is a bad word, but it's not. It's a good thing, right? We want healthy obedience in our life, loving and obeying God. If we love Him, we will obey His commands. It's right there. If we love Him, we obey His commands. So I want to tell you to beware of what I would call easy believism. Easy believism. What is easy believing or easy believism? It's this type of faith that some people say, I believe in Jesus, but I do what I want, or I'm not going to follow His teachings. You know, and maybe some people aren't brash enough to just say that outright, but they say, I believe in Jesus and I'm saved, I believe in the Lord, but then they live however they want to, and there's very little, if any, evidence that Jesus has changed their life. And we don't want this type of faith, this easy believism, you know, having Jesus but having no commitment in our life. It's wanting Jesus as a Savior, wanting Jesus as a ticket to heaven, but not acting in our life as Jesus being Lord, as Jesus being our teacher. We don't want that in our life. If we love Him, if we believe in Him, then we will obey His commands. And the great commands of Jesus are easy to remember. It's love the Lord God with all that you are, and love your neighbor as yourself. And who is our neighbor, Jesus teaches us? It could be anybody. It could be even your enemy. It could be somebody who's very different than you. And so if we are believers in Jesus, we want to love God with our whole heart, soul, mind, and strength. And we want to love our neighbor as we want to be loved. We want to love people, anybody and everybody. Jesus has just said in this previous section that we are going to be known by our love, that we are called to love one another. And that's how other people will know that we are His followers. So beware of anybody teaching that, you know, Christianity is just about believing and going to heaven. And, you know, it's about so much more. It's about becoming like Christ. Now, we also need to remember that we are not saved by our behaviors or our works or our acts. We are saved by grace through faith. So yes, there should be evidence of God's love in our lives, but I'm not saved by how much I love others. We aren't saved by the quality of how we love others either. We should want to love others, but we aren't saved by that. We're saved by Jesus Christ. So we are saved by Him and by trusting in Him, believing in Him, right? But if we are followers of Him, truly believers, then we will have evidence of Him in our life. It's evidence. It's not works that saves us. It's evidence of Him. So I just want to say this. Examine your own life. Let the Holy Spirit help you do this. If you say you believe in Jesus, examine your own life. Is there evidence of Christ's love in you? You may not be perfect, none of us are, but do you want to love God? Love Him more and love others in this world, even people who are different than you, have different views on COVID or politics or whatever. Is there evidence of Christ-like love in your life? Now, the demons even knew that Jesus was the Son of God. They knew that. They had a head type knowledge, but they didn't believe in the sense they didn't trust Jesus. They didn't want to follow Jesus. They didn't want to love like Jesus. So we don't want to just know that Jesus is the Son of God. We don't want to just know that Jesus is the way to heaven. We want to trust that He is our way. He is our new life. He is our hope. He is the way that we are forgiven. It's about trusting Him. Taking our life and clinging to Him, that type of trust, not just a head knowledge. When we say we believe, it's not just agreeing to an idea. The demons agree to the idea that Jesus is the Son of God, but they don't follow Him, right? So we need to trust Him and trust that His way, His teachings are the truth, the better way of life. And He is the one that can shape us to be who we were supposed to be like Him, to be filled with love. And the good news is that if this sounds overwhelming, I can't be like Christ. How can I have Christ-like love in my life? I have all kinds of wrinkles and issues and challenges. Well, the good news is we don't become like Christ on our own. We have a helper, the great helper, the Holy Spirit. So let's look at God's plan, the Trinity's plan for helping. Because if we look at this, in this section, we can see that the Trinity here in our section, Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. And this is a rich section, a deep section about the reality of God. Jesus again saying that, you know, He and the Father are in this together. And Jesus obviously teaching about the Holy Spirit, who is God as well. So Jesus is revealing the Godhead's plan for us, for helping us. to be his people on planet Earth. And he says he's going to leave the helper, the Spirit of Truth. And this word for helper that gets translated as advocate, you might have counselor, you might have comforter in your translation. In the Greek, it's this word paraclete. Paraclete. It's got two words basically put together, para and kaleo, which just means someone who stands by and advocates for. Someone who comes alongside you like a lawyer or a counselor, or someone who comes for you and helps speak for you on your behalf, pleads for you, who wants the best for you, who knows better than you, and wants to lead you and guide you. God says, I'm going to give you the paraclete, the helper, the guide, the Spirit of Truth, who will lead you and help you. And God is going to give this to all who trust their life to him. He can't give it to just anybody. Now, the Spirit of the world, the Holy Spirit works in the world and will try to convict non-believers of all kinds of things and works with whomever. But the Spirit can only indwell in people who have trusted in Jesus Christ, right? Trusted in Jesus Christ. And this is the long-held plan of God to restore human people to this intimate relationship with God. If we go all the way back to Genesis, right, the story of humanity is that we fell and intimacy was broken. God used to walk with Adam and Eve in the garden, but then sin entered the world and death entered the world, and this intimacy with God was broken. But God's plan was to restore that, to take what was broken upon himself, upon the Son, Jesus Christ, and make us able to have intimacy with God again, closeness with God, God walking with us. So Jesus Christ, in bearing our penalty, in defeating sin, in defeating death, he makes those who trust in him able to have the Spirit of God in us. This is part of the good news. This is the big story, that on our own, I can't have God's perfect Spirit dwelling in me. But if Jesus Christ changes me and takes away all my sin and makes me righteous, then I'm like the temple in Jerusalem. I'm like that Holy of Holies, not by my own record, but by the grace of Jesus Christ covering me. I can have the Holy Spirit in my life, and that intimacy with God is restored. This is God's plan A, to bring his Spirit into the world. And Jesus Christ came to make that possible, but then Jesus was going to leave to be with the Father, but leave the Spirit to be with his people, to dwell inside of God's people. And God's people are going to be the living temples on earth, representing him, being his body on earth. This is radical good news, friends. It's not that your sins are forgiven and you're getting a ticket to heaven. That's a small version of the good news. Jesus Christ came to restore our relationship with God so we can be completely forgiven, made completely righteous. We can be made holy vessels by his action, by what he did, by what Jesus did, so that the Spirit is with us. And now we can have closeness with God all of our days here on earth, and we will be with God one day forever, as he makes clear in this section as well. So this is good news. You're never alone when you believe in Jesus Christ. The Holy Spirit is with you. It's the great solution to the human loneliness issue. God is with us. His Spirit is with us. Even if dementia robs your mind, God's Spirit will never leave you. He is right there, closer than your very, very breath. God is with us. And there's good news here, too, that God's plan is that he wants this relationship for planet Earth, and he wants this relationship after we depart planet Earth. Jesus is coming back. He's going to accomplish his mission, as he's telling his disciples here on earth. And then he's going to leave, but he is not done with his people. He's going to leave the Holy Spirit for the people of Christ to do their mission. And then Jesus Christ is going to return one day. Now, the disciples are getting all this teaching, and it's too much for them at the moment, right? I mean, just think about the deep teachings that Jesus is teaching them, and they have no clue in real time what he is saying, I don't think. But this is an example for us that the Spirit of Truth will help John and the other disciples later on remember and understand the things that Jesus was teaching them in their time with him. The Spirit of Truth will lead us into remembrance of what God is teaching us. And so sometimes in real time, we don't get the things that God wants us to get, but he also knows that we're not getting them. And he leaves the Spirit of Truth with us, and the Spirit is going to teach us over time. And some of those lessons we learn in retrospect. and the Spirit brings up scriptures or brings up experiences and connects things and teaches us. And so John, writing this as a much older man, is being aided by the Holy Spirit to remember these deep teachings of Jesus that he probably didn't get completely at the time, right? That's good news. So a simple point here today from this section is that God is real for us. And we want the world to know that God is real. So many people ask that question, how do you know God is real? Well, Jesus' answer to that is God is real, and people are going to know that through God's Spirit living in you. And we can be the flesh and blood evidence of the reality of God. God is real. Now, Jesus, in this time, is not here in flesh and blood himself on planet Earth. But God's presence is still here in the world. The Holy Spirit, by God's plan A, is to dwell in the world in lives of people who trust Jesus. Right? And so that's really important to understand. That you have God's reality with you, and you can show others that God is real. And part of that evidence is we love people not because they first loved us, but because Jesus loved us and we're called to be his presence. So we love others, even if they're enemies, even if they've done no good to us. Why? Why do we do this ridiculous kind of love, or it's called ridiculous by the world? Because Jesus loved us first, right? We're the evidence of God's reality to the world around us. We are God living out his mission, Jesus' mission here on earth. And so our job, your job, is embrace the reality of God. God's Spirit is with you. If you believe in Jesus Christ, embrace the reality daily that God is with you, no matter where you are. If you're in isolation, quarantine, you know, a hospital room, a hotel room, your daily normal life, your desk, your school, God is with you. And God wants to go with you to the world around you. Now, how are people going to know God is real if God's people don't go and show them and live out Christ-like love in their life and share the truth and the hope that we find in Jesus? So how do we do that? What can we do? Well, for the believer, we need to live in tune with the Spirit. And I'm just going to share four things we can be as we live in tune with the Spirit. Be a believer. Be a student, be a servant, be a sharer, okay? We say here, worship, grow, serve, and share. But be a believer, be a student, be a servant, be a sharer, okay? If you're a believer, believe that you've been given the Holy Spirit. Just believe that. Believe that in a daily way and receive it. Receive it. And the Holy Spirit can help you each day, convict you of sin, teach you truths, encourage you, empower you, show you that you have a gift, can help you to stand up and speak to somebody who needs to hear. Right? Be a student. Realize that you have many things to learn. We all do. No matter how long you've been a Christian or how short you've been a Christian, you have something to learn. The Spirit will teach you. Be a servant. Believe that you have gifts. We all have different gifts in the body, but you have a role and you have gifts. That no Christian is given to be in the back seat and do nothing. God has something for you to do. How are you going to be a servant of what God is doing in the world? What has he gifted you to do? What abilities do you have? It's an insult to God if you say, I have none, because that's not true. God is in you if you believe in him, and God has gifts for you to use. What are your gifts? What are your roles? If you don't know what they are, part of my job is to help people find those gifts, to explore those, to explore roles and how they can serve God's mission in their life. So feel free to ask about it, but don't just say, I can't do anything. Everybody can do something. That's the way God's Spirit works. And be a sharer. Be ready to share the good news that you've experienced. Be willing to share the good news that you've experienced. Be open to it. Ask daily, Holy Spirit, give me opportunities to share. Give me the words to say. The scriptures teach us that if we have that attitude, he will give us opportunities. He will give us words to say. We need to be ready and willing and learning and present. And then God will use you. Believe it. Believe it. Believe that God wants to empower you to love people in your life this week. Let's pray. God, I thank you that you want to use each and every one of your believers. Help us to believe that. Help us to believe in your plan A, that you came to earth to restore us to intimate relationship with you, and you have given us your very Spirit. Oh, Lord, we thank you. Such great news. We pray this all in Jesus' name. Amen. The next steps should be on the screen there. There's three of them. If you want to just rejoice with me that God wants me, God wants you, and he offers us the Spirit's presence. If you want to select that as the first one, go for it. If you want to memorize verse 18 of chapter 14, I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. That's a good, encouraging verse, really easy to memorize. Let's do that. And then a breath prayer that you can pray through the day is help me listen to your Spirit. Lord, help me listen to your Spirit. There's a great scripture that says, the down payment from God is the Holy Spirit. Ephesians 1:14. The Holy Spirit is this down payment from God. So believe that, friends. Amen.
To him who sits on heaven.
friends. I hope you've taken advantage of our spiritual growth guide. If you haven't, we can make a copy available for you really easy. Just let us know in the comments or email us next@palousechurch.org. Just a brief moment on the spiritual growth guide. If you turn to page 184, you can find the three-letter words that give us a basic theology of self-care. And we talked a little bit about awe last week, of being in awe of God. The next three-letter word is who. We need to remember who God is and who we are. And if we do that daily, it's really, really good for us to remember that there is a God who is in control. Who is God? God is creator. God is sovereign. God is powerful. But God is also personal, compassionate, sent his son for us, gives us his spirit, like we heard in the message today. So remembering in a basic way in our daily life who God is really important. But who is a word that also can remind us who we are. Who are we called to be? Well, God calls us his children. We're not orphans. We're invited into his family. We're vessels of the Holy Spirit. We are empowered by God. That's who we are. So remember who God is. Remember who we are. There's more in the Spiritual Growth Guide, and I hope that encourages you this week. Friends, we have good news. The Spirit of Truth has been given into the lives of believers. Let's remember this daily. Let's believe and trust the Spirit to do God's work in us. Have a great week, friends. God loves you. Thank you.
Hey everyone, I'm Tim Sievers, the Connection Director at... You gotta stop bombing.